about National Monument Stadium. Look,
what is that?
That thing.
Oh, mate!
I'm in a tuk-tuk and I've got some notes. So today is a vlogumentary all about the killing fields. It is my second visit to the killing fields. It's not going to be a good day, but it's an amazing story. One that was brought to the attention of the Western world, more or less at the collapse of the Khmer Rouge and the end of the killing fields. As whilst the Khmer Rouge occupied Cambodia and went about ethnic cleansing the whole country, the world didn't know. They didn't have a clue about it. They really didn't know. It wasn't until the end of that occupation by the Khmer Rouge. Basically, the Vietnamese invaded in big time. They invaded into Cambodia and ended the reign of the Khmer Rouge. And it was after that that their massive famine was there, then awakened the world with a famine. Basically, the refugees and the people of Cambodia, they were basically starving, and they ended up at the embassies of the USA and any other Western. And obviously, the Western world was shocked to find out what had happened, and it then went on a massive campaign, something like what, $8 billion. US dollars plowed into Cambodia to try and put that right. But that wasn't that easy, because the Khmer Rouge were a recognized organization by the UN. So the UN were actually taking in the Khmer Rouge as refugees. And they almost had an uprising. Pol Pot almost made it back into power or so. It was crazy and it was outrageous. And that was the aftermath of what happened. So I'm going to tell you what happened. Now, the film The Killing Fields is a portrayal of an American journalist and a Cambodian photographer, basically in Phnom Penh when the Communist Party, hang on, what they call the Communist Party of Kampuchea, were backed by the Khmer Rouge, and they basically in 1973, the National Army of Cambodia had a civil war against the Communist Party of Kampuchea and basically lost. And that was when the Khmer Rouge took over and implemented. Year Zero was implemented by the Khmer Rouge, which is a cleansing program. It's shocking. It's perhaps one of the most shocking stories in history, a genocide. Outside between 1973 and the close or the beginning of 1979, close to 3 million, almost a third of Cambodian residents were killed, slaughtered, massacred and executed. Basically, anybody who opposed the CPK and the Khmer Rouge were murdered. Buddhist monks were murdered. Temples were destroyed, monasteries were destroyed, people wearing glasses like me were executed. Anybody representing any form of education were either executed, killed or murdered. Schools, excuse me, I lost track. Bullets, I'll do that again. Any forms of capitalism were all abolished. All. Hang on. You alright, mate? Need some water? I bet his bike's overheating. Nah, mate, he'll have to fill his tank up. That's still raining. Let's have a look out. Oh, man, okay. That's still pretty grim. So, all capitalism throughout Cambodia was totally abolished. Any schools? Let's have a quick look. Sorry, hospitals, schools, factories, shops and marketplaces were all shut down, and huge communities of people en masse were just sent out into the countryside. They were. Now, hang on, let me. With no food, no medical assistance, no help, no supplies, no farming tools or any basic facilities whatsoever. So again, more died, basically through malnutrition, starvation, exhaustion. Thousands, obviously, disease-ridden. Can't even read me, I'm bloody writing. Man, it was grotesque. It was grotesque. And where I'm off to today, the killing field, it's just one of the killing fields out of about 400 that lay around Cambodia, which has its own shocking story from my point of view. I'll tell you about it when we actually get there. Former business people, bureaucrats, teachers, and anyone with an education were sought out and executed. Even people who wore glasses, people speaking foreign languages, and even people who were crying in the streets over loved ones were all taken and executed. They were. It's a horrible state. Now, even another thing that is important to this, where I haven't gone today, there is a museum in Phnom Penh where a section of that museum is basically as it was back in 1973 to 1978. Now, the torture prisons were put into place. The most commonly known one is in Phnom Penh, known as the S21 prison. And the museum is the Tol Sleng Museum of Genocide. Right. Now, it was a former school, and the classrooms were turned into cells, gymnasiums turned into torture chambers, and the dining halls were execution chambers. Between 1975 and 1979, 17,000 people, political enemies to the CPK and the Khmer Rouge, were sentenced to this prison. They were documented and they were photographed. And it is said that only 12 of those 17,000 actually survived, and 4 of those were children. Shortly after the prisons were put into place, next put into place were labour camps, where the prisoners were obviously sent out from the prisons to the actual labour camps, where they were worked to death, again starved, and just died through sheer exhaustion. And birth records were destroyed, mass executions took place, and the Khmer Rouge did not use any bullets. No, instead they used pickaxes, they used bamboo, and they used knives in their killings, their murderers, and their executions. And the remembrance site that I'm now off to, that I'm going to visit today, is between, what you read, I should have measured it, it's about 8 kilometres away from the centre of Phnom Penh, and it's the Cheon Ek site. And it is the site where the prisoners from the S21 prison were actually then sent. They were sent and transported there. They were given shovels and they had to then dig their own graves.
This.
G'day. And welcome to today's vlog, the killing fields. And this is the Cheon Ek Genocidal Center, the killing fields, just one of 400 of these sites around the whole of Cambodia. And as you come in, you can pay just $3 there at your entrance fee. There you go, and we walk in. Did you enjoy that, guys? What did you enjoy it? Did it not make you feel a little bit horrible after going around there?
Kind of,
yeah. Okay, thanks for that. Have a good day, guys. All the best. That is the feeling you will get if you come here
and tour around and leave. It leaves you, it leaves you with something horrible in your stomach once you actually understand and realize and see how sick this tourist attraction really is. Now the word, the phrase, the killing fields, now that term was phrased by Diff Pran. Diff Pran was the Cambodian photographer to which the film The Killing Fields was based upon, and it was his term. He actually got captured, the guy. If you ever watch the film, you'll see what happens. Good morning. Cheers, buddy. It's a fantastic film, and it was through his story that the world got to know the truth about what actually happened here. Man, watch the film and see what that guy went through. Look at this. This is... Oh man, this is just the start. These are all the skulls that were discovered. Victims between 20 to 40 years old lay in these casks. Obviously, what is it? No photo. Okay. Wow. And it is quite a dreary, grey day, which is almost kind of fitting. Cheers, buddy. So we'll have a little walk around here. Ah, no, this tree. Now, everything in this site has reference, right? Every little thing to what went on. Oh man, well, this is new. I can't remember seeing that before. But also, when we walk around here, you'll see, because the graves that were dug were all very, very shallow graves, so you can actually still see some of the mounds. I want to walk, because, oh man, there's loads. This has bloody changed it, which wouldn't surprise me. So we're on the path. Oh man, I don't know what this is. Okay, I see something. But yes, this is it. You see the mounds, and with these are the shallow graves that have been reopened, so they can put all those skulls, etc., into that remembrance thing. And again, that's what all these are. As we look round, these are, like I say, the shallow graves that have been reopened. As you can just see across here, look. This dike was constructed in 2000 to be used as a conservation facility to prevent destruction of excavated mass graves from floods. Ah, that's that dike. There's a dike down the side there. So yeah, that's what that's been dug for. So these, like what I was saying, these mass graves don't fill in with water, but obviously best laid plans and everything. Oh man. Wow. So, put my glasses on. Oh, no way, my moats have got all wet. So hopefully I can read the last section. Finally, right? Cambodia was liberated by Vietnam. Vietnam invaded. They did. Now, on the 25th of December, 1978, Christmas Day, the Vietnamese launched a full-scale invasion of Cambodia and subsequently occupied the country and removed the government, which ended the genocide. But that is where the story actually started again, because thereafter the famine then set in, and then of all the children, you've seen as a child, right? I remember that was my first thing that I knew about Cambodia, because we all did sports at school, charities to send money to Cambodia. The whole of the Western world, well, I don't know the whole of the Western world, but Britain and America are actually in shock, and they sent so much money here and help to try and put it right. And we, I remember as kids, we used to see them, the starving Cambodians covered in flour, you know. I remember it, and I did some charity sports for those people. Now, here's one of these glass cases with some remains still in. I don't know if that's one person from a grave or whatever. And there's fragments of some bones on the top there. And there used to, well, there was a sign that would tell you exactly who that person was or the age. I'd better leave them bones where they are. And they're probably dug, like, so all these holes are mass graves. And there's listening points here, so you can get a tour guide. Now, I think that is the tree. Oh man, I think that is the tree where they used to hang a speaker from to play music to drown out the people's screams and the children's cries. I'm pretty sure what that is, that will say on that tree. Excuse me. Oh, man. Oh no, it's a chicken in the background. The tree was used as a tool to hang a loudspeaker which makes sound louder to avoid the moan of the victim where they were executed. And that's what that tree is there. Noise. Excuse me. Now here, like I say, you can imagine, it's like I say, more mass graves. This whole site is a mass of mass graves. Oh man. Okay, pieces of bones remaining after the excavation in 1980. In here, I've only got even more small bones. Are they teeth? No way, there's a box of teeth there. I better leave them there. I'll take a few teeth. I could do with some of that. I could do. I wonder if I find a crown in there. Oh man, and that's just another. And look, a small sandal. And all the teeth again in the corner there. And a little hairbrush. Oh man. Oh man. It is. It's shocking. Shocking. To walk around here. More and more. Oh, you all right? Enjoying this? It's horrible, isn't it? I know. It's my second time here as well. How bad is that?
Have you been
out? I came here 11 years ago, mate. I felt, when I left, it was horrible, but it is what it is, you know.
Is it closed?
What?
Is that closed?
Closed? Oh, but, I don't know, mate. That could be rubbish. It could, because each one of these is a mass grave, you know. Every single one of them. Mm. So it could be. This, yeah, could be, excuse me. And this tree, as you can see, oh man. There were 400 of these, by the way. There's only one. The Khmer Rouge, there were 400 of these fields all around Cambodia. This is the only one that's been excavated, because it's owned by a Japanese businessman that's close to Phnom Penh. Oh man, another huge grave. And 100 victims, children and women, whose majority were naked in these mass graves. It is, like I say, if you come here, the people I talk to, it does leave you feeling with a bad feeling. But to know that it's owned by a Japanese businessman, I do stress that, because it's the most sickening tourist attraction in the world. And the reason why he bought this one and excavated it, it's because it's the closest to Phnom Penh. Oh man, and here are, look, more rags. After the mass graves were exhumed in 1980, they left underground rags of victims. Clothes came up after raining and were collected and kept. And what that guy said, the bits of clothing sticking out from the side is probably how much rain that they've had in Cambodia. It probably is excavating it quite naturally. More and more stuff will come out. But the drains certainly haven't worked to keep these mass graves. Man. Mass grave of 166 victims without heads. That's what it says on that sign. Oh, man. It's a harrowing, harrowing, harrowing experience. Okay, that says a former Chinese grave pre-75. Ah, that's with the stone. Ah, okay, so this would have been, there's some more bricks over there. It would have been something before it became what it is now. Now this is a huge mass grave here. I'm not going to read on that sign. Mass grave of 450 victims. The killing tool storage room. And here we go, because bullets weren't used. They wanted to save money. And now the tools. Here it was. Here you go. Place the tools such as shackles. Oh man, leg irons, hatchet, knives, much worse than what I was saying, digging hose. Man. They were all stored in the storage room. These tools were lost in 1979. Fuck. I reckon someone nicked them. Not lost. Things don't get lost. Hello. Sorry, I was just reading that, right? That's probably the worst atrocity I've seen yet. Together for the clean Cambodia, green Cambodia. You've seen how much litter and rubbish and what I've seen on the roads here. Cambodia is pretty far from clean. I'd say it's perhaps worse than Indonesia from what I've seen, even coming here today. It is. Okay, ceremonial kiosk. Before 1975, here was a Chinese cemetery. Thin was the public kiosk that was used for keeping a coffin and offering to spirits before the corpses were finally buried in the tomb. Okay, so it was a former burial site for the Chinese. The chemical substance storage room, no way. Oh, they scattered these substances over the dead bodies of the victims once after execution. This action had two purposes. Firstly, it would eliminate the stench from the dead bodies, which could potentially raise suspicion among people working near and by the killing field. Oh man, and secondly, was to kill off victims who were still alive. Oh man, a chemical substance storage room was lost in 1979. That's terrible. How can a chemical, man? Oh, there's a water closet through there. Now there is a little museum at the end here, I guess, which is, yeah, here, it's just here. Wow. That'll be filled of pictures, I believe paintings. Quite a lot of stuff in here. And it says no photo. Well, I did take some photos from here before. Take your boots off. Oh man. Excuse me. Please take your hat.
Yes.
I'm not going in. Nah. It's just more old faded pictures. Oh man. I bet it says please take off your hat and your shoes. It's me out of my shoes. So we're going in. Wow. Okay, that is the state of the Democratic Cambodia, the Communist Party. They are the people. They've probably all been tracked down and killed and executed by now. You would have thought it. Okay, yeah, these are the leaders. Look, Pol Pot right at the top. There's all these faded photographs. Oh man, these would be the photographs of the victims. There's an Australian guy there, man. Fucking hell. Oh man, Korea. Yes, they're the documentations that the, as you can see from the prisons. I think, I'm not sure, this Khmer Rouge cadres, or maybe cadets, I'm not sure if they're... Hang on, let's have a look. I'm not sure if these are victims. Don't know. Oh man, that's the extermination camp. Look. Wow, I've just... All these are graves. Each and every one of them. Wow, and these are photographs from the unearthing from 1980 of what they found. That one particular. And again, social distance. These are some of the clothes. Look, the shoes, ribbons, clothing, children. And these weapons, some of the weapons. Oh man, the shackles, man. Oh. Horrible. Horrible. Oh man, all the bottom jaws. Ah, oh, this is men's clothing and women's clothing here. And the boots they would wear. Wow. It'll be fun, man. Wow. Okay, now if you want to pause and read that, that'll be up to you. That will tell you just about everything. Pol Pot died under house arrest in 1998 under house arrest. Bloody good news. Oh man, there we are, look, the killing tree. That's devastating. Oh mate, and there is that man with a baby. Can you see that picture? Wow. Wow, outrageous. Oh, I should have gone down the other bit over here. No one's told me I can't film. There's no photos. Oh.
Also, there were nine European people also executed there.
No video?
Yeah.
Ah, okay, no problem.
Yeah. Thank you, I could.
I must go to rain again. No video, film. Oh, man. Oh, what a shame. Okay, 1 second. Oh, okay, that's the rain now starting to rain again. And I think I've more or less come to the end. I may have missed one or two little bits, but there's more here. Oh, man. So forgive me for that. But I think you got the general idea and impression about this place. If you come at a Phnom Penh and you really, to be honest, I wouldn't. Phnom Penh's like, I'd avoid the place at all costs, really. There isn't anything here but doom and gloom. I mean, there isn't. But, right, I need happy ending. So, give us a second, I'll come find happy ending. Oh, there you are, the end scene. And it looks like, look, the cloud is shifting through. Day could brighten up. And I've just returned from Smile. Not cheap in there. And I'm off tomorrow. I'm gonna go up to Central Market later. I might even do a vlog round there. I just seen that there might be some interesting stuff in there. Anyway, enough about that. Enough about tomorrow. Today is today, and I'm having a proper happy ending. But actually, not as happy as one thought. As I thought these were 48 cents. I was looking at the wrong label, wasn't I? No, a dollar something. Which ain't too bad still. A dollar ain't too bad. Cheers. Mmm. Oh man. That's definitely the best thing about Phnom Penh. So I'm now gonna have a little feast. Up on my table, my veg, I have some salt, I've got some cheddar, still got a bit of my gouda from yesterday. I got emmental in there as well, there's two there. But I did buy these plain crackers because they've got no brown bread or anything. And I was just like, you go and open them, look, they're fucking baby crackers, but for fuck, they were $2 for fuck's sake, and they don't look like they've been imported. But I've also treated myself to finest quality sausage, ham, and bacon. Well, which one is it? Is it? I don't know, I'm having a bit, I don't eat processed meat. I've had none of this crap for ages, but it's a lot better than, I had a meal out last night, it's crap. And that weren't very good. I had a pack of pow actually. I had a pack of pow and two little tins of beer and they charged me $8.50. Fucking hell, man. Well, so stuff around here, too expensive. It's fucking Cambodia. It's good little caption area, so you either pay all the tourist fucking prices, which are really expensive, and all them, none of them bars, I've been down there, are really hard work. And the food here is pretty good. To be honest, it's a lot worse than what it was when I was here before, which is, and I was speaking to a Bangladeshian guy outside Smile, because we both wanted to buy coffee. And fucking coffee's like $8 for a jar, and $12 for a jar in this cafe. It's like fucking outrageous. And I don't understand, because you can go and buy it for fucking 300, 400 baht from Thailand. And the import chart, like I say, this board across, and it should make things not cheaper, not more expensive. Anyway, he was moaning about how disgusting it was here. So fucking hell, if a Bangladeshian guy's moaning about how dirty and disgusting this place is, then believe me, it fucking is. No, surprisingly so. So, and it's a massive city, really big. And it's hard work getting about. The roads are chock-a-block and they're wet. I tipped my tuk-tuk driver. I give him 15 instead of the 10 I agree. So fucking, when he was driving back, man, the amount of, it was, I was having a hard job actually sitting in the tuk-tuk, in the back. I don't know, poor bugger was having to drive for all that, right, so I'll give him $5 tip. He deserved, man, well deserved, yeah. I don't often tip, you know, but poor fucker. So he's happy, I'm happy. Right, so I'm now going to get fucking tucked in.
tucked up more like. So, fucking hell, check, that's nearly gone. Oh, so cheers. Thanks for watching, and until next time, au revoir.